Good morning and welcome to St Mark's Newtownards. My name is David Shepherd and thank you for joining us to worship God together today. The Lord be with you and also with you. So far, 1 million people have applied for their £100 voucher from the executive to spend in local shops by the end of next month. It seems that there's something we can nearly all agree on in Northern Ireland. When you apply online, you receive an email confirming that your application has been received. However, that email isn't the same as receiving the card. In fact, it says this: it is likely it could be a number of weeks before you receive your card, but don't worry, because you should have enough time to spend your £100. All that has been confirmed is that you would like to receive a voucher. Is it just me, or does that sound less than certain? On Thursday of this week, there will be a service of confirmation here with Bishop David. At that service, 11 people from St Mark's will say in front of the bishop and everyone else that they believe and trust in Jesus. And they'll confirm their desire to serve and follow him. It's really special to hear someone say that and know that that's what they want, and that it's a real encouragement for the rest of us as God's people as well. But as amazing as it is, that confirmation is only part of following Jesus. It's important and necessary, but like the confirmation of your application, it doesn't mean you have received the voucher. The bishop will lay hands on each person, praying that God's Spirit will confirm, strengthen and guide them as day by day they live up to their confirmation and the commitment they're making. It's not just our confirmation that makes us followers of Jesus, but the confirmation of God, the Holy Spirit. That means we live for him because he lives in us. When we believe in Jesus, God's Son, we receive the Holy Spirit as God's real ownership on us. He puts his Spirit in our hearts as a guarantee of what is to come. Everything we inherit along with Christ. Let us worship God and praise him for his goodness in the power of the Spirit. The love of God has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. We dwell in him and he in us. Give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him, sing praises to him, and speak of all his marvelous works. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, a sinner condemned unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. For me it was in the garden, he prayed not my will but thine. He had no tears for his own grief, a sweat drop the blood for mine. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How my sins and my sorrows, He made them His very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall it ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior love for me. When with the ransom in glory His face at last shall see, joy through the ages to sing of His love for me. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall it ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
St. Paul says, since we live by God's Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. We confess the ways we have ignored the Spirit's leading as we measure our lives against the fruit of the Spirit as it grows in us. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, and peace. Forgive us, Lord, when we have pursued our own interests rather than the things that make for peace. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. The fruit of the Spirit is patience, kindness, and goodness. Forgive us, Lord, when we have been intolerant of other people's feelings or uncaring about their needs. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. The fruit of the Spirit is faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Forgive us, Lord, when we have let people down or failed to place our trust in You. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Collect for today, the 19th Sunday after Trinity. O God, without you we are not able to please you. Mercifully grant that your Holy Spirit may in all things direct and rule our hearts. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Psalm 90, beginning at verse 12. Teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts to wisdom. Turn again, O Lord, how long will you delay? Have compassion on your servants. Satisfy us with your loving kindness in the morning, that we may rejoice and be glad all our days. Give us gladness for the days you have afflicted us, and for the years in which we have seen adversity. Show your servants your works, and let your glory be over their children. May the gracious favour of the Lord our God be upon us. Prosper our handiwork, O prosper the work of our hands. Our reading this morning is from Mark chapter 10, verses 17 to 31. As Jesus started on his way, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. "Good teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus answered, "No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother." "Teacher," he declared, "all these I have kept since I was a boy." Jesus looked at him and loved him. "One thing you lack," he said. "Go. Sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me." At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great wealth. Jesus looked around to his disciples and said, "How hard is it for the rich to enter the kingdom of God?" The disciples were amazed at his words, but Jesus said again, "Children, how hard is it to enter the kingdom of God? It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were even more amazed and said to each other, "Who then can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "With man this is impossible, but not with God. All things are possible with God." Then Peter spoke up, "We have left everything to follow you." "Truly I tell you," Jesus replied, "no one who has left home or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for me and the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age. Homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields, along with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last first." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. Friends of ours once lived in Australia, where his work had posted him along with his wife. And one evening his business had arranged a party for clients, and they got talking to another very friendly couple. At the end of the evening, this other couple gave them their address and invited them to dinner at their house the following week. My friends decided to bring a bottle of wine to say thank you and to share over dinner. Now, they weren't long married and only the husband was working, so they couldn't afford a really good wine. They got what they could. They set off for the evening and found themselves driving out into the countryside as they looked for the address. They finally arrived at a large set of gates with a driveway that stretched as far as they could see. As they drove along it and a very large house came into view, they realized, to their horror, they were driving through a vineyard that obviously belonged to this couple. As they looked at the very ordinary bottle of wine they had brought, they seriously thought about turning round, but their hosts were there waiting for them as they pulled up at the door and they handed over their gift. We believe that rich people lack for nothing. What do you give someone who has everything? If our friends had known how rich these people were, that they owned a vineyard, they wouldn't have brought them a bottle of wine. But in our reading today, a man who is very rich runs to Jesus, who had nowhere to live, because he needs something. He needs to know what he must do to inherit eternal life. Jesus treats him as the same he would treat anyone. "What do the commandments say about living a good life?" he asks him. Is the young man disappointed that Jesus isn't telling him anything he doesn't already know? Or is he relieved that he's on the right track because he has kept all the commandments since he was a boy? That's impressive in anyone's book. Either way, he's looking in the wrong place. Eternal life is not to be earned by keeping the commandments. The Apostle Paul himself knew that. He had a lot going for him when it came to keeping the law, being a righteous person, but he counted all that as rubbish compared to knowing Christ. When it comes to eternal life, we are not to let our own righteousness either assure us we are good enough for God or trouble us that we need to do more to be good enough for God. Do we find ourselves thinking that same way? That the good we do is good enough for God? to accept us? Or asking the same question as this man did, what more can I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus says in John 17 that the eternal life which he has come to bring is to know God and Jesus Christ, the one he has sent. So Jesus looks at the man with love. That's an amazing thought. But Jesus looks at everyone who comes to him with love, that we might know him. In love, he doesn't contradict the man's mistaken idea of what makes someone good. He doesn't interrogate him on how well he really has kept the commandments. Rather, he receives him as he receives everyone who comes to him, just as he is, treating him, looking on him with love. For it is out of God's love that Jesus was sent into the world. And because he loves him, Jesus tells the man how he can find the one thing he lacks, the assurance of eternal life, knowing God and Jesus whom he has sent. Go, he tells him, sell everything you have and give it to the poor, then come, follow me. How unfair, how unreasonable, we might think. What kind of person would do something like that? Well, at that time, the idea of turning your back on wealth in order to gain spiritual riches wasn't an unusual one. Many people, including pagans, taught that true riches were not found in what you could store in a money chest. What we only now realize Jesus could tell all along, what lay behind this man's question and his whole life, is his wealth. As the man hears what Jesus says, a sadness falls over his face and he turns away, walks from Jesus because he had great wealth. How tragic, how sobering that someone who had so eagerly run towards Jesus looking for the answer to that deep, the deepest question of life from the one person who could properly give it, gets that answer and decides the cost is too great. Jesus doesn't blame him for turning away. He doesn't send him away either, nor does he force him to stay until he changes his mind. But he deliberately and lovingly puts his finger on the one thing that was the cause of what this man lacked, that is his wealth. And let's be clear that this is what is in view here. This is the whole point. Jesus says it himself, how hard it is for rich people to enter the kingdom of heaven. The disciples are amazed that Jesus has let this man walk away. What a difference his money would have made to their mission. These are the kind of people you want on your own side. They are also amazed, as we might be today, that someone who has succeeded in life, who is rich as well as righteous, who's God-fearing, who's decent, finds themselves outside of God's kingdom. Such is the effect of wealth upon a person. And Jesus warns us how dangerous wealth, money, is. How it will keep us from eternal life. How it causes us to stumble. He uses well-known words to illustrate his point. It's easier for a camel, the largest known animal at that time, to pass through the eye of a needle, the smallest imaginable thing, than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of heaven. There are two reasons why money is a dangerous hindrance, a stumbling block on the way to the kingdom. Firstly, money tells us that we can do everything. Those who have money are those who have made it in the world, whether they've been born wealthy or gone from rags to riches, by fair means or foul, wealth is a measure of success. When the rich man asks, What must I do to inherit eternal life? He's sure he can do whatever it takes because he's a man of means. His confidence comes from his riches. How ironic that someone who has the wealth to get virtually anything is unable to do what Jesus says, because that will mean giving away the very thing that gives him his confidence. And that's because of the second reason money is a danger. Money tells us we can't do anything. Money makes us comfortable, but also makes us very afraid of what will happen when we lose it. Without money, we tell ourselves, I'm nothing. I can't do anything. I can't survive. It literally says what I am worth as a person. Nicky Gumbel, who created the Alpha Course, heard someone who had been brought up in the Depression of the 1930s being interviewed on the radio. This man had felt the need for security and consequently made lots of money. When he was asked what effect this had had on his life, he replied, "For the first 6 weeks, I woke up feeling really secure. Then I started to worry about how I was going to hang on to all the money I had made." When Jesus tells the man to give away everything he owns, it's his worst fear come true. Having plenty to live on means he has nothing to live for, not even the offer of eternal life from Jesus himself. Money is a danger, a trap to us all, but it is a particular trap to Christians. If money makes us either secure or afraid, that means we have begun to serve it, to worship it, when instead we are called to worship, to serve God. And as Jesus says, you cannot serve both God and money, because you will love one and hate the other. If the followers of Jesus have the same attitude to money as everybody else, then, as John Piper puts it, we betray Jesus. If we look like our lives are devoted to getting and maintaining things, then we will look like the world. And that will not make Christ look great. That will not magnify Christ. Instead, he will look like a religious side interest that may be useful for escaping hell in the end, but doesn't make much difference in what we live and love here. He will not look like an all-satisfying treasure, and that will not make others glad in God. Don't underestimate the danger. Our witness to who Jesus is, the whole mission of the church, can be derailed by a wrong attitude to money. We will lack trust. We will no longer have faith in God to lean upon him as we cling on to material wealth to give us life, rather than accept the price Jesus has paid once for all to save us. Trusting in his cross means taking up our cross, letting go, risking everything to follow him. Jesus says, losing our lives for his sake and for the gospel is the only way to truly save our lives. As we hold on to our wealth, we will make the camel smaller or the eye of the needle wider to excuse us from the obligation to give it up or give it away. We will tell ourselves that what are really luxuries are necessities. We will lack compassion for those who are less well off. We might even despise them for being so, even though our attitude to money and to possessions actually causes their poverty, as we demand more stuff at cheaper cost. Jesus gave the rich man a wake-up call. We need to wake up to Jesus' words too. When money makes our world go round, we, like the disciples, say, if eternal life means getting rid of anything that stands in the way of total commitment to Jesus and love for his people, even money, then who can be saved? listen to what Jesus says. If it's left up to people, it's impossible. But not with God. With God, all things are possible. We're excited about our £100 voucher. We're going to get free money. What could be better than that? But Jesus says, when we give up the things we count precious in this life for his sake, we will receive 100 times as much in this present age, not just in heaven, in this present age. And how do we think that is going to happen? By using our wealth, our possessions, in a way that shows God is our treasure and our joy. So how about using that voucher to make someone else glad in God? How about asking God, praying how best we can bless someone else by, in the way we use our voucher? We hear the stories of missionaries who were down to their last penny to look after the people they cared for when the exact amount arrived, just as it was needed most. But that didn't come out of thin air or by coincidence. It happened because weeks or months earlier, a trusting brother or sister felt prompted by God's Spirit and compelled by God's love to give away what they had, to write that check and post it halfway around the world. Let's not rule out being that person who could make such a difference by what we give away. And thankfully, we see this in our own church. Peter, Stephen, and myself are able to minister here without having to support ourselves, thanks to the generosity of God's people. We were able to hold a cake sale yesterday and raise nearly £1,000 because 60 people decided to give the time and the ingredients to bake a mountain of buns and cakes. Last week, 5 people from St. Mark's took part in the Belfast Marathon to raise money for Christian Aid and have raised an amount to bless others because others responded to that and gave of what they had. Jesus isn't just interested in our money, he's interested in our lives. We are to give up the control that we have over our money and the control that money has over us, trusting in Jesus to be open-handed and open-hearted, especially to the needs of others. Let's take Jesus at his word that blessings are multiplied through what we give up when we make him our greatest treasure and when we trust that all things are possible with God.
I will offer up my life in spirit and truth, pouring out the oil of love as my worship to heaven. In surrender I must give my every part, Lord, receive the sacrifice of a broken heart. Jesus, what can I give? What can I bring? So faithful a friend, to so loving a king. Savior, what can be said? What can be sung as a praise of your name for the things you have done? Oh, my words could not tell, not even in part, of the depth of love that is over by this thankful heart. You deserve my every breath, for you paid a great cost, giving up your life to death, even death on a cross. shame away. There defeated my sin. Open up the gates of heaven and a beckon me in. Jesus, what can I give? What can I bring to so faithful a friend, to so loving a king? Savior, what can be said? What can be sung as a praise of your name for the things you have done? Oh, my words could not tell, not even in part, of the depth of love that is owned by this thy full heart.
We affirm our faith through the words of the Creed. Do you believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us, and rose again? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known in the world? We believe and trust in him. This is the faith of the Church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray to our Lord Jesus Christ, with whom all things are possible. The response to the words, Lord, who makes all things possible, is, hear our prayer. We pray for our world, a world created perfectly, but now torn apart by war, violence, and inequalities. We give thanks for the abundance of resources you have provided for us and pray that all in authority use and share out those resources fairly with everyone. We thank you for providing us with an example of how to live as we pray that all people strive to live like you. Give your wisdom, compassion to all those in authority, that they may be mindful of the needs of their people and provide equitably for all their people. Lord, who makes all things possible, hear our prayer. Continue to recharge your church so that your purpose is at the center of all we do. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons as they continue to serve their communities. And we especially give thanks for Chris, Peter, and all those who help lead at the Glen and the West Winds. Give to all those within your church a renewed sense of purpose and strength to speak your word with great boldness, like you did with the rich man. Renew the spirit within your church, particularly in places where it's not safe to be a follower of Christ. And give them the comfort of knowing that you are with them and they will receive much more than in this present age. Lord, who makes all things possible, hear our prayer. O God, through the teaching of your Son, Jesus Christ, you prepared the disciples for the coming of the Holy Spirit, the Comforter. Make ready, we pray, the hearts and minds of your servants who seek the gifts of your Spirit through the laying on of hands. We pray for Rick, Julianne, Ryan, Aaron, Lorraine, Nikki, Emily, Gemma, May, Sandra, and Johnny. As they draw near to you with faithful hearts, may they be filled with the power of the Spirit's presence through Jesus Christ our Lord. Lord, who makes all things possible, hear our prayer. Reshape the community around us to reflect your teaching. Give us the courage to share what little we may have with others who are less fortunate than ourselves. Remind us of your message that our eyes should be fixed on what treasures we may have in heaven, not on earth. We know that with you anything is possible. Stretch out your hands and perform your signs and wonders within us through how we, as your church and communities, reach out to those who are suffering, the hungry, the refugees, prisoners, and those who are persecuted. As we remember your forgiveness towards us, we forgive those who have brought suffering to others and give thanks to those who bring care and relief. Lord, who makes all things possible, hear our prayer. Reveal yourself to those in need, those who are tempted, in despair, and those who are sick. We pray especially this morning for Elizabeth, Adam, Muriel, Sydney, Ken, John, Helen, Rosemary, Doreen, Ken, Ryan, Sam, Terry, and Mandy. In the silence of our own hearts, we lift up the names of those to you that are on our heart at this time. Comfort all those who are bereaved at this time, especially the families of Betty Lilburn and Eileen Robinson. May they know your presence in their time of grief and be assured that their loved one is with you. Lord, who makes all things possible, hear our prayer. Almighty God and everlasting Father, we thank you that you have brought us safely to the beginning of this day. Keep us from falling into sin or running into danger. Order us in all our doings and guide us to do always what is right in your eyes. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We conclude our prayers this morning with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. May the hope of God fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now, evermore. Amen. Thank you again for joining with us today. As we keep in step with God's Spirit, may Jesus always be our greatest treasure. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.